All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce the second to last speaker of this program. Marc Thiessen is a former White House chief speechwriter, Fox News contributor, and a columnist with the Washington Post, where he writes a weekly column on politics, foreign and domestic policy. In 2018, the Post syndicated his column nationally for the first time, and it was picked up by 178 newspapers, the most successful launch of a syndicated column in Washington Post history. His column reaches more than 11 million readers. Marc served as a member of the White House senior staff under President George W. Bush, where he was chief speechwriter to the president and the lead author on two State of the Union addresses, and worked closely with President Bush on hundreds of speeches. Before that, Marc served as chief speechwriter to the Secretary of Defense, Donald Rumsfeld. He was in the Pentagon when it was hit on September 11, 2001, and traveled 250,000 miles around the world with Rumsfeld, visiting more than 50 countries, including multiple visits to Afghanistan and Iraq. His inside account of the CIA's terrorist interrogation program, Courting Disaster, was a top 10 New York Times bestseller. He is the co-author with former Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker of the bestseller Unintimidated. Before joining the Bush administration, he spent 7 years as spokesman and senior policy advisor to the Senate Foreign Relations Committee Chairman Jesse Helms of North Carolina. He's a resident senior fellow at the American Enterprise Institute, where he studies American presidential leadership and U.S. foreign and domestic policy issues. He's co-host of AEI's flagship podcast, What the Hell is Going On?, where he has interviewed Nobel Prize-winning researchers, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalists, foreign and military leaders, Democratic and Republican members of Congress, cabinet secretaries, governors, and President Donald Trump, among many others. He appears several times a week on Fox News Channel on shows including Fox News Sunday, America's Newsroom, America Reports, and the Faulkner Focus, The Story with Martha McCollum, and Special Report with Brett Baier. His wife, Pamela, served as the Republican staff director of the Senate Homeland Security Committee. They live in Alexandria, Virginia, and have 4 children. Let's give him a warm welcome.
Let's all taped together. Awesome. Well, thank you very much for having me today. It's great to be with you. Let's put this down here. Welcome to Washington, D.C. For those of you who are from out of town, or as Scott Walker likes to call it, 46 square miles surrounded by reality. Of course, if you're coming from a college campus, this may seem like reality. I promise you it's not. As Jack indicated, I've had a fascinating career. I worked with some of the greatest conservative leaders in our nation's history, from Don Rumsfeld and Dick Cheney to George Bush and Scott Walker. I served in government at the dawn of the War on Terror and saw that war up close, from the planning rooms of the Pentagon to the Situation Room, the Oval Office, and the main battlefronts in the Middle East. I was in the Pentagon when it was hit on September 11, 2001. I felt the building shake. I smelled the smoke. In the months that followed, I traveled 250,000 miles around the world with Secretary Rumsfeld, including his first visit into Afghanistan right as the Taliban regime was falling. They're back now. When U.S. forces liberated Iraq from Saddam Hussein, and then I moved on to the White House, worked for President Bush, wrote dozens and dozens of speeches. One of my favorite speeches that I had the pleasure of writing was President Bush's speech on the South Lawn welcoming Pope Benedict to the White House. It so happened that speech took place on Pope Benedict's birthday, and so I actually had the privilege, President Bush invited me up to the residence for a birthday party for Pope Benedict, and I got to meet him, and we had a receiving line, and just to show you what a gracious person President Bush is, when it came my turn, President Bush introduced each one of us to the Holy Father, and President Bush introduced me and he said, he's the one who wrote the speech, which is a very moving moment for me, for the Holy Father to know that. I was telling that story to a Clinton speechwriter, and he said, oh, I had a really similar story. I worked on President Clinton's State of the Union address, and he invited me to a reception in the residence, too. And he introduced me to somebody, said, he's the guy who typed my speech.
That's the difference between the two men. But over 5 years at the White House, I traveled around the world with President Bush. I worked on speeches aboard Air Force One and in the Oval Office. Every day I came to work at the White House, I had to pinch myself. I half expected a Secret Service agent to walk into my office and say, "Mr. Thiessen, there's been a terrible mistake. Please come with us." But I had a front row seat to history, and today I'm a columnist for the Washington Post, where I have precious conservative real estate in one of our nation's leading liberal newspapers. I'm a commentator on Fox News. I got to work on a book with a great conservative leader named Scott Walker and work with him closely. I'm a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute, which is our nation's leading free market, free enterprise think tank. So as conservative careers go, I've hit the jackpot. I can't believe how blessed I am. But I'm telling you all this because for one simple reason, because it all began 30 years ago when I was sitting right where you are at a Young America's Foundation conference. I was a student at Vassar College, and no one assigned me to read Hayek or Friedman or Russell Kirk. It was through YAF that I was exposed to the world of conservative ideas. It was through YAF that I met fellow conservatives in other campuses across the country and realized that I wasn't alone. And it was through YAF that I discovered my vocation and decided to make a career fighting for the principles that we all believe in. YAF gave me my start in the conservative movement, and today YAF is doing the same for thousands of young men and women like you on college campuses across the country. And I have to tell you, I love conferences like this because when I look into your eyes, I see myself three decades ago. Back then, I had no idea the adventures that were ahead of me in my career, but you have similar adventures in store for you, different from than mine to be sure. But if you decide to make this a vocation, you're going to have incredible experiences serving a cause larger than yourself, serving your country, and fighting for the ideals that we believe in. And I also want to tell you just how impressed I am by all of you, because it takes guts to stand up for conservative ideas on college campuses today, and in high schools, too. I think some of you are from high schools as well. And I know because I've been there. I can't begin to tell you how important it is to know that groups like YAF and all of the people, all of us in the larger community that support YAF, that we're all behind you as you fight for these ideals. And it's particularly important these days because the threats to free speech are so much worse than they were when I was in college in the 1980s. When I was editor of the conservative student newspaper in the 80s, we invited YAF's founder, William F. Buckley Jr., to come to my college campus. And he agreed. Actually, you know, I had no idea how to find Bill Buckley. So I just got tickets to a taping of Firing Line, which was his television show, and went up and introduced myself. And he was the nicest man you could ever possibly meet. And it turned out his sister and his wife had been roommates at Vassar, and so he was very intrigued by a guy from Vassar who was inviting him to come to a conservative student conference at Vassar. And so he agreed to come. And it was a private event. It was a conference. We organized a conference for all the conservative student newspaper editors from around the country. And so it wasn't open to the whole school, but at the time, there was no conservative more famous or controversial than William F. Buckley Jr. And I mean, he literally, for those of you who are, I'm sure all of you in this room are familiar with him, but he built the conservative movement. There would have been no Reagan presidency without Bill Buckley. And so for the left, he was the most hated man in America. And so Bill arrived in his stretch limo, and the campus left immediately sensed a disturbance in the force, and word started spreading that Bill Buckley was on campus. And so they amassed an army of leftists to march on Joslyn Hall, which was this hall where we were hosting a dinner in Bill's honor, to protest. And it was a rainy evening, but the foul weather didn't deter them. And so Bill arrived, and we escorted him through a side door into the dining hall. It was a large, elegant dining hall with glass windows on either side. And so there we were, the campus right, drinking wine, smoking cigars, listening to Mozart with William F. Buckley Jr. And outside in the driving rain was the campus left with their nose pressed against the window protesting us. So as Bill got up to speak, protesters got increasingly agitated, and they eventually broke into the lobby of the building. And they were prevented from rushing into the hall only by the exertions of the Vassar men's rugby team. That is actually a thing. And they prevented them from coming in, but one of the protesters snuck into the basement and flipped the fuse and put us in complete darkness. And I remember Bob Terrell, who was the founder of the American Spectator magazine, he was there as well to speak, and he shouted out, "Bill, the left is trying to show us how they see the world." And soon the lights came on, and Bill finished his speech, and it was just a night to remember. But the point is this, as agitated as the campus leftists were, they pressed their noses to the glass, but they didn't break the glass. They cut off the lights, but it was a prank. we were never worried about our personal safety. Today, things are very different. I mean, we all just heard the story of what happened to Riley Gaines at San Francisco State. She's the NCAA champion swimmer that had her title basically stolen from her by a biological male. She gave a speech at San Francisco State and was attacked by a mob of hundreds of protesters. She had to be boarded up in a classroom for 3 hours until the campus police came to escort her out. So lesson one, don't go to San Francisco State. Choose your college wisely. There are schools that still believe in free speech. But two, woke intolerance is growing on our campuses today and infecting more and more schools, and more schools that had been resistant to it are succumbing to it. And it's not just college campuses. Last year at Yale Law School, students disrupted an event featuring Kristen Wagoner of the Alliance for Defending Freedom, which is a conservative group that defends religious liberty. And as a Yale law professor started to introduce her, a group of students rose up and started to shout her down, heckle her. Several reportedly held up their middle fingers, and they were eventually forced to leave the room, but they stood outside the hall, pounding on the walls, trying to disrupt the event, and the campus police had to escort her out because they were afraid for her safety. The Alliance for Defending Freedom isn't a fringe group. They've won 12 Supreme Court cases. This is a serious organization. You would think that even if you disagreed with them, these students would want to hear from somebody who had successfully won 12 cases in front of the Supreme Court if you're going to be a future lawyer, but they weren't interested. And then just a few weeks ago, the same thing happened at Stanford Law School, where you had a Federalist Society invited a judge named Kyle Duncan, of the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, to come speak on campus, and he was shouted down by a group of woke students, including some that yelled at him that they hoped his daughter would be raped. And amazingly, the Stanford Dean for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion was there, and instead of quieting down the protesters, she joined in. She said, as I look out, I don't ask what's going on here, I look out and I say, I'm glad this is going on here. This is at one of the nation's most prestigious law schools. And we've seen these kind of illiberal tendencies on college campuses for a long time, but this isn't a college campus, it's a law school. These aren't kids, they're not sophomores behaving sophomorically. They're adults who have chosen the legal profession. The purpose of the legal profession is to settle our differences through reasoned argument, right? Present opposing views to a jury or a judge and settle the case based on the merit of your arguments. If you can't accept that principle, you have no business being a lawyer. And so this is a critical threat to our democracy, even more so than what's happening on campuses, because the law is the critical foundation on which all of our freedoms rest. And these are the people who are going to be deciding the law one day. They're going to be clerking for federal judges. They're going to become federal judges. And they don't have this basic principle. But ask yourself, why is this happening in American law schools today? Because it's happening in American campuses, because the college campuses are the ones that are training the people who apply to law school and become lawyers, and they're not teaching them basic respect for free speech. They're teaching them that we have to put diversity, equity, inclusion above the right to free expression and free assembly. And in fact, in the name of diversity, equity, inclusion, we have to crush free speech because it gets in the way of diversity, equity, and inclusion. This is what the left does. It takes words that sound positive and fools people into accepting them. I mean, equity, look at equity. Equity sounds great, doesn't it? Who could be against equity? Me, I'm against equity, because equity sounds like equality, and we all believe in equality. What is equality? Equality is an equal starting line, right? We should aspire to a society where everybody has a shot at the American dream, and they have the chance to succeed or fail on the basis of their merit and are not held back by anything that is extrinsic to them. Equity doesn't mean that. Equity means an equal finish line, regardless of merit or hard work, right? Equity means that whether if you work hard and get an A in your class and Sally doesn't do her homework and gets a C, we should just take away a little bit of your grade and you both get Bs, because that's fair. Because why should Sally get a C? Because you had advantages. You grew up with all sorts of advantages. They don't like merit. They're waging war on merit. And that's what this whole thing is all about. And they choose words like equity because it sounds like something that people will listen to, and people who aren't listening carefully will be fooled. And if you want to know how pernicious this is, consider this. LinkedIn just reported that the second fastest growing job in America after vaccine administrator is DEI manager. companies across this country are hiring political commissars whose job is to enforce DEI ideology in the school places you work for. Back in the 2000s, when I worked for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, I went on a congressional staff delegation to communist China. And we visited a plant called Shanghai GM, which was an American car company building cars in Shanghai. And they were giving us a tour. And we passed by this office. And it was the office of the Communist Party official assigned to the company. And so I asked the manager, what is the Communist Party's role here? And he said, well, actually, you know, every Western company here in China has a member of the party who's on site. And he said, it's kind of like having a really enthusiastic of the Democratic or Republican Party in your office. And I said, oh, do you have members of the Chinese Democratic Party here too? And he didn't appreciate the question. But the point was, every business in communist China has a political commissar whose job is to make sure that everybody toes the party line and nobody goes astray. And now fast forward 20 or 30 years to now, and the second fastest growing job in America is political commissar in these companies. And if you want to know how pernicious that is, just look at the recent Bud Light controversy. Right? So, you know, there's a woman there who is the marketing manager, about 39 years old, and she said, she did this video where she said she wanted to elevate and evolve the brand and move past its image of frat boy out of touch humor and promote inclusivity. I'm sorry, the job of marketing manager at Bud Light is not to promote inclusivity. It's to sell beer. You're a beer salesman. That's your job. And she doesn't seem to understand that that's her job. And it seems like nobody at Anheuser-Busch asked a simple question. Will this marketing campaign sell beer? And the answer is obviously no. It has caused beer sales to drop at Anheuser-Busch. And why was nobody willing to ask that question? Why did no one stand up to say, this might not be such a good idea? Because maybe they might be branded as transphobic. Because maybe the DEI manager, someone would go to the DEI manager and say, I've been made to feel unsafe. So nobody says, dumb idea. And so when businesses across the country have people in there whose job is to enforce DEI ideology, nobody's going to say, dumb idea. This is not going to help us sell beer. And then you've got the problem, which is the colleges today are training a generation of young workers who, truth be told, really want to work for nonprofit social justice organizations, but don't want nonprofit social justice salaries. So what they're doing is they're going to the private sector because they want private sector salaries and trying to transform those companies into social justice nonprofits. And so like the Bud Light marketing director makes $435,000. What do you think the marketing director of the Sierra Club makes? Not the same. And so if you want to change the world, more power to you. Take the pay cut, go work for the Sierra Club. But if you want to work at Anheuser-Busch, your job is to sell beer. And this is the problem. People used to think that the way to change the world through the private sector was to invent some great product that made people's lives better and sell it. And capitalism and free enterprise was making people's lives better. Now it's all about social justice and diversity, equity, inclusion. So this is what you're facing today. These are the headwinds you're going into as college students going into the real world. And then you're also facing unprecedented cultural crosswinds that I didn't experience when I was in college. How many of you saw the Wall Street Journal poll that came out a few weeks ago, which showed that patriotism, religious faith, interest in having children, interest in community involvement, all the priorities that have defined us as a country are receding in importance for the American people? So poll showed, for those who hadn't heard it, the number of people who said that patriotism was very important to them in 1998, 70%. Today, 38%. And among young people your age, 23%. That is a huge decline. The number of people who say religion is very important. In 1998, 62%. Today, just 39%. Number of people who say having children is important. 1998, 59%. Today, 30%. The one thing that seems to be rising is having money is very important to you. 1998, 31% said that was important. Today, it's 43%. So it seems like the selfless parts of our national character are receding and the selfish parts are growing, which is not a good sign for the future of our country. When it comes to having children, in 1960, almost the average children per household, 3.65. In 1998, it was still a replacement rate of 2. Today, 1.64. Children. We're not even replacing ourselves as a society. Now, you know, and the least likely to replace themselves are liberals, which is kind of ironic because they want socialism, but they won't produce the taxpayers to pay for it, right? And the decline in fertility is related to the decline in religiosity, right? Because we had, you know, we used to be governed by the Judeo-Christian religion, for us as Catholics, the Catholic religion, whose mandate from the book of Genesis was go forth and multiply. And by the way, God didn't say go forth and replace yourself. He said go forth and multiply, right? So the divine standard is three or more. But if we're no longer multiplying or replacing ourselves, right? Why? Because we've replaced the Judeo-Christian religion of go forth and multiply with the religion of climate, which says, oh my God, the world is ending. I can't bring children into it. Right? We all have a yearning for a higher power. So if you take away religion as we know it, they're going to find something else. And what they found is climate change as the new religion. And then there's the decline of patriotism. And this is directly related to the critical race theory in our schools, which is teaching young people to believe that this country just isn't so great after all. If you indoctrinate a generation of children into thinking this country was founded not on the principles of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, but to perpetuate and sustain slavery, that's going to depress patriotism. People aren't going to get enthusiastic about that. Case in point, I'm not going to show the video, but on Independence Day a few years ago, the New York Times posted a video op-ed challenging what it called the mythology of American greatness. And basically they said, today, we've been told that America is the greatest country in the world, but today America's, we're just okay. We're just okay, they said. It's like a caricature of how conservatives think the left sees America, except it wasn't a caricature, they actually said it. And you know, our kick-ass democracy, the Times said, is not that big a deal because a lot of countries have freedoms. Well, the fact is, the reason a lot of other countries have freedoms is because of the United States of America. It's because our founding fathers pioneered the principle of popular sovereignty, where governments answer to the people instead of the other way around. At the time of our founding, the rest of the world was ruled by monarchs. Our founders established the first country in human history that was founded not on blood or soil, but on an idea, the idea of human liberty. This is why nationalism in Europe may be a threat, but nationalism in America isn't a threat, because nationalism in Europe is exclusive. It's like anybody can't be French, but anybody can be American, right? Ours is an inclusive nationalism. Ours is an inclusive ideology. But for most of our history, democracy, like we have it today, was a global outlier. At the eve of World War II in 1938, there were only 17 democracies in the world. It wasn't until 1998 that there were more democracies than there were autocracies in the world. Why is that? This dramatic expansion of freedom didn't just happen. It's because of America. It's because we defeated the twin totalitarian ideologies of Nazism and communism and unleashed the greatest expansion of human freedom in the history of the world. And that unprecedented expansion of freedom has unleashed unprecedented prosperity. Here's a fact that I'm sure nobody has told you. In 2018, the Brookings Institution had a study. And this is what they found. For the first time since agricultural-based civilization began 10,000 years ago, the majority of humankind, and this is in September 2018, the majority of humankind, 3.8 billion people, live in households with enough discretionary income to be considered middle class or rich. Did you know that the majority of the world is middle class and rich? For all of human history, most people lived in poverty. Only a small elite had any kind of wealth or discretionary income. And because it wasn't socialism that did that, it was the collapse of socialism. It was the expansion of freedom and free enterprise and the ability to pursue your dreams around the world. Today, 4 out of 5 people who still live in tyranny live in one country, communist China. Most of the rest of the world is living in freedom. And so, you know, every country that enjoys democracy, they enjoy democracy because the United States of America, because we're the country that stood on the frontiers of freedom and stopped the Nazis from taking over the world and then prevented the communists from taking over the world and unleashed this freedom. We invented the light bulb and the iPhone. We put a man on the moon and put a rover on Mars. The reason why we have a crisis on our southern border today is because millions of people want to come here to enjoy what we have, to enjoy the freedoms that we have. So the time to start worrying about our country is when they stop coming to the southern border and trying to get in. Because that's when we know that we've done something wrong, where we've lost that magic that makes us great. So, you know, but without us, the world would be mired in darkness and totalitarianism. And that's why bringing it back to your campus, why what you're doing in fighting the woke ideologies on campus is so important, because the future of our freedom depends on it. If a new generation of Americans grows up not believing that America is an exceptional nation, not understanding this history, they won't be willing to defend it. And they won't be willing to defend our ideals on the world stage. I had Congressman Mike Gallagher, who is Scott Walker's policy director, foreign policy director on his gubernatorial on his presidential campaign, and who's now a congressman. He's the chairman of the House Select Committee on China. And I had him on my podcast the other day, and he said something really interesting. He said that Communist China's strategy to destroy America, one of the key pillars of that strategy, is convincing us that we're not the good guys. Because if we don't believe that we're the good guys, then we won't stand up to them. Because how can we do it? How can we oppose the incarceration of 1 million Uyghurs in concentration camps when we're a society built of intrinsic racism built on slavery? Who are we to lecture China on its human rights record? So they're dead serious about displacing us and spreading their ideology as the dominant ideology in the world. And part of that strategy is to convince us that we're not the good guys so that we're not willing to defend our values. If we had believed that we weren't the good guys 60 or 70 years ago, we wouldn't have sent troops across the world to fight the Nazis. We wouldn't have stood on the frontiers of freedom to defeat Soviet communism. And so, you know, this decline in patriotism isn't just a question of, oh, isn't it sad that people don't love America so much? It's a threat to our national security. It is when you're defending American greatness on campuses, you're not just fighting the intolerant campus left. You are fighting a critical battle in the Cold War, the new Cold War that we have with China. You're fighting a battle for the soul of our country, whose outcome rests the battle for freedom in the world today. So how do you do that effectively? That's what I came to you to talk about today. The first step is don't let the totalitarians set the tone for the debate on campus. The best way to do that is stand out in contrast to them as exemplars of tolerance and openness and free discussion of ideas. Don't bait them with needlessly provocative speakers. Choose people who represent what we truly believe and whose ideas you're proud to defend and who say them in a way that you're proud to defend them. Your goal isn't to own the libs. I know there's some people out there who are professionals at owning the libs. Your job is to persuade the persuadables, right? Your job is not to have an incident on your campus that goes viral and gets you on Fox News. Or it gets you on, you know, on the talk shows and everything like that. It's to engage in thoughtful discussion, provide students on campus with reasonable alternative to the toxic culture that the left is spreading on your campus and that they're seeing every day in their classrooms. When you engage the campus left, be defenders not just of conservative ideas, but of open-mindedness, critical thinking, free debate. Because unlike the left, we don't have to shut down debates to win it, right? We have nothing to fear from an open discussion of ideas. And the left's intolerance has to be challenged, but it's an opportunity for all of you. And let me close with you with a story that illustrates that. As many of you know, Ronald Reagan started out life as a liberal Democrat. And he famously said, "I didn't leave the Democratic Party, it left me," right? The difference between me and Ronald Reagan, other than I didn't bring down Soviet communism, is that the left didn't leave me, it kicked me out. So when I got to campus, I wasn't as smart as all of you because I was still a liberal Democrat. And I got into campus, and the big issue back then was South Africa and the apartheid regime in South Africa. Is everybody familiar with apartheid? Right. And so there was a big movement on college campuses to divest from South Africa, to stand with the African National Congress and the black majority. And so I joined the Student Coalition Against Apartheid and Racism. And I helped organize protests to get the college to divest from South Africa. We had rallies in front of Barclays Bank, which was was one of the banks that was heavily invested. And one day I was doing some research on apartheid, and I came across a video that described human rights abuses that were being conducted not by the white regime, but by the African National Congress, which was the group opposing the apartheid regime. And it showed a video of something called necklacing. Does anyone know what necklacing is? Necklacing was what Winnie Mandela, who was Nelson Mandela's wife, when he was in jail, he was running this wing of the ANC. And when they thought that someone was collaborating with the regime, they would have a show trial, and then they would take a used tire and put it around their bodies, fill it with gasoline, and set them on fire. And they would film this to show it to people so that people would know that if you collaborate with the white regime, this is what's going to happen to you. I was horrified by this, and I was against apartheid, and I was fighting against it, but I was absolutely horrified when I saw this. So I went to the meeting of the Student Coalition Against Apartheid and Racism, and when we had an open discussion, I brought this up, and I gave an impassioned speech saying, look, we have to be against human rights abuses from either side, and so I think we should issue a statement to, condemning this. And I explained what it was and what was going on. It's like crickets in the room. And the Student Coalition was run by this white South African Rastafarian type guy who was just like, he was appalled. But they didn't say anything. They just moved on the meeting and nothing happened. Next day, I came back to my dorm room and I opened the door and a note had been put under my door. I had been purged. They held a vote and I crossed an ideological line at that. And so I was a traitor. And so they kicked me out. So I was politically homeless. So like that, I was a liberal with no one, the liberals wouldn't have me. And so not long after that, I'm on the train back to New York City, with going back to Vassar after going home to New York for a weekend. And I bumped into a fellow student who was the editor of the conservative newspaper named Brian Brown. And he read the paper called the Vassar Spectator. And so I was telling him this story. And he said, come write for us. And I said, I'm not a conservative. He's like, so what? Write whatever you want. And so I did. I joined the conservative newspaper as the liberal columnist for the conservative newspaper. And I started hanging out with conservatives and talking to them. And I was just attracted by the openness, the diversity of views, the libertarians fighting with the traditional conservative, the paleocons, the neocons, and all the different cons. There were so many cons. And I didn't know which one I wasn't any of them. And then I started to become one, and I had to figure out which one I was. And it was fascinating. It was fascinating intellectual tradition, but experience. But long story short, here I am 3 decades later talking to you at a young conservative student newspaper conference after a career working in the conservative movement. And the lesson of it is this is how you convert a liberal, right? I'm here to testify. Wasn't going to testify, but I'm here to testify. Yeah, I was lost, but now I'm found. Right? This is how you convert a liberal. The left is intolerant, and they will treat you with utter contempt. Don't respond in kind. That's harder to do than it sounds, because when people treat us with contempt, it's really, really hard not to fall into contempt ourselves. Contempt is a virus. It's infectious. But we have to resist it because it has no place in our political discourse. We should have contempt for North Korea. We should have contempt for Iran. We should have contempt for the ISIS terrorists who put people in cages and burn them alive. We should have contempt for the Russian war criminals who decapitate Ukrainian POWs. We should have contempt for them. We should not have contempt for our fellow Americans who disagree with us on politics. And they shouldn't have contempt for us, even at that, but we can't control that. That's a fundamental difference between the right and the left. We think the left is misguided. They think we're evil. That's the fundamental difference between us. And we can't be like them. We have to be better. We have to hold ourselves and each other to a higher standard. That's especially true for us in this room who share not just a love of conservative ideas, but a love for our Catholic Church, which teaches us to love our enemies. And the first way to do that is to recognize that our fellow citizens who disagree with us are not our enemies. They're our fellow citizens who disagree with us. How many of you in this room have someone you love who disagrees with you on politics? Do they hate America? No. They're your loved ones. They're your mom. It could be your mom or dad, your sister or brother, crazy uncle who at Thanksgiving who's caught up in, who loves Bernie Sanders. I mean, it could be anybody. When you hear fellow conservatives owning the libs and saying liberals hate America, they're talking about them. You should be offended at that. You should stand up for them and say, no, they don't hate America. They just disagree with us on politics. And stand up and defend them. Contempt is bad for the soul. Contempt is also a really, really bad technique for winning converts. No one in the history of the world has ever been insulted into agreement. You moron. Oh my God, you're right, I am a moron. No one does that. That conversation has never happened in the history of mankind. So keep in mind, when you're on campus, there are three different audiences on your campus that you're talking to. True believers, those who are already with us. Hostiles, those who will never be with us. And persuadables, those who are not yet with us. That's your audience, the persuadables. The persuadables are the ones, And here's the interesting thing about persuadables. They're watching how you interact with the hostiles. They're watching how the hostiles interact with you and making decisions based a lot on that. They may not agree with us yet, but they're repelled by intolerance. They're repelled by this thing, and that's our opening. That's our opening to get them. The left's contempt is your opportunity because contempt is repellent to normal people. So you want normal people on your campuses who are not filled with contempt, who see the intolerance of the left, to look at you and say, those are the kinds of people I want to spend time with, even if I don't fully agree with them. Those are people who are not going to cancel me if I ask the wrong question, or purge me if I raise questions that they don't want to answer, or call me names, call me a bigot, say that I'm transphobic, that I have a mental disorder. Those are people I can have a conversation with and disagree and still have a beer afterwards and be friends and talk about sports and other things that we care about. Be the normal people, because there's so many abnormal people on your campuses. Be the normal people. Be the island of sanity amidst the chaos, the sea of chaos that the left is creating on your campus. Provide your fellow students with a refuge for thoughtful, reasoned debate and discussion. Seek out and welcome those who disagree with you. Give them a platform to speak and a platform to have reasoned debate. If you are in the conservative newspaper, bring in a liberal columnist like me. They might end up being a conservative columnist one day. If you have, ask your liberal professor to write for your conservative newspaper or come to speak to your group and have a discussion with a group. Any smart liberal professor would love to sit down with a group of conservative students and talk about an issue and have that discussion. Invite them to write for your newspaper. Make it a play. Make your forums and your newspapers and all the ways that you're reaching out, make that a place where conservatives and liberals come together to have reasoned debate and discussion. And over time, you'll win more converts that way because openness and tolerance are attractive, and contempt is much more attractive than hostility and contempt. Because unlike the left, we don't have to shut down debate to win it. We don't have to delegitimize the other side by calling them racists or misogynists or fascists or white supremacists. That's a sign of weakness of their arguments. They can't. The reason they want to shut down debate is because they can't win the debate on the basis of their ideas. We can debate on the merits because our arguments have merit. And I'll leave you with this. Former president of AEI, Arthur Brooks, who is one of my mentors, he tells a story about the first time he was invited to speak at a Baptist church. He's a Catholic like us, but he speaks to all sorts of different groups around the country. And after he was done, as he was walking out of the church, he saw a sign above the door leading out, and it read, "You are entering mission territory." That was the sign. When you leave here from this conference and go back to your schools, you are entering mission territory. You're preaching the good news of freedom, free speech, and free enterprise. And you can't do that effectively if you allow yourself to have contempt for the people you're trying to convert. Jesus dined with sinners. We must dine with liberals. Always remember, there are lots of people like me on your campus. Liberal Democrats who are conservatives in their hearts and they just don't know it yet. Convert them. Open the eyes of the blind. I was blind and now I see because somebody tried to convert me with love. So be the person who opens the minds of people to conservative ideas. You can do the same thing for students on your campus today. Speak boldly, proclaim your principles, but do it with love because you're entering mission territory. Thank you very much. Happy to take your questions.
All right, we have some time for questions. Go ahead and line up, state your name, what school you go to, and then your brief question.
And we can talk about this or we can talk about anything else. Any issues of the day, whatever you want to talk about.
Hello, thank you for your lecture. It was really cool. My name is Vincent Corey. I represent St. Louis University. I was doing a project with a friend, and I was trying to find somebody to resemble an American who would have resembled Augustus Caesar. And there were two people I suggested. The guy told me, hey, you can do anybody you want, it'd be pretty cool. And I started with Abraham Lincoln, just how it is. And immediately he goes, Lincoln? He owned slaves. And apparently he thought that he actually did, and apparently it's not even true. But knowing that, I want to ask you this, because I want to open their eyes. If I wanted to, tell people about defending the legacy of George Washington regarding the other things that he did, the slavery stuff. How would I properly address that to people on campus?
So the first thing I would tell them is that it is always problematic to judge people in a previous moment in history by today's standards, because they'll no one if you do that, you'll have no heroes, because every hero in history has been flawed in some way. And slavery was the original sin of our founding, and it took us a century to get rid of it, and then another century to make our way towards greater equality in this country. My pastor, Father Charles Pope, who's a dear friend of mine, he's a priest here in Washington, D.C., he has a phrase. He says, "I'm not who I want to be, but I'm not who I used to be," right? But there's a change happening in me, right? That's true for America, too. We're not yet who we want to be, but we're not who we used to be. And that's important, too. Second, once you get past the idea that we're going to be judging people by modern standards, why was George Washington perhaps the greatest political leader of all time? And I say that boldly, because he was. Because at the time, the world was ruled by monarchs, and no one had ever stepped down and voluntarily given up power. And George Washington was so popular in America that he could have been proclaimed king. And he didn't want to be king, and he didn't want America to have a king. He wanted us to have a country built on popular sovereignty where the people rule. And so after two terms, he voluntarily stepped aside, and King George could not believe it. And ever since then, until 2020, we've had peaceful transitions of power from one president to the other, from one party to the next. It's the greatest innovation in the history of the world. And the literally, your freedom to call George Washington a racist and a slave owner is based on his will, the freedoms that he brought to this country and the system that he created, and the might of the United States military across two centuries that has defended our freedom and allowed it to expand across the world. So the fact that you're even allowed to say that about the leader, one of the great founders of your country, is a testament to his greatness.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Felicity Schmidt. I'm from Christendom College. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for your talk. That was such a fresh, interesting take on the matter.
Thank you.
I just have a question about the practical standpoint or aspect of this approach of dining with the liberals. How do we first maintain a healthy balance between the two and really guard against our own views and not get sucked into the lies of the culture? And going off of that, how do we also make sure that we are coming off as Republicans, as right-sided individuals, and not cause confusion among the community, thinking that we are actually supporting the leftist movement?
So the kind of people that are going to engage you are not the kind of people you don't want to be associated with, right? Because the people who will accept your invitation are not the people who are going to shout down the speakers or all the rest of it. They're going to be thoughtful people who just disagree with us. And I don't think anybody's going to have trouble confusing you with them just because you're together. I mean, whether they're writing in your newspaper or speaking at an event. I mean, for example, one way to do it is if you're going to have an event, Instead of, I'm not suggesting you should invite liberal speakers if they got enough of them on campus, but invite a liberal speaker to debate a conservative and have a reasoned debate. I mean, there's lots of ways to do it where no one's going to be confused about you. And as for worrying about, we shouldn't be worried about engaging other people with ideas and losing our sense of who we are and what we believe in, because, we're generally right. Two, we're not right about everything. And they could raise some issues that we might find out. I'm a little bit more liberal on that issue than conservative. There's nothing wrong with that. Most of us are a mix of ideas. And then third, you can't be an effective conservative if you don't know what the liberals are saying. Just like they can't be effective liberals. One of the problems with stovepiping is we're not even talking to each other anymore. And then we start taking down straw men. right? You know, maybe if you engage with a thoughtful liberal, he might make you think, or she might make you think, and they also will make you a better conservative because you'll have to actually confront some ideas that you might not have heard listening to other conservatives, critiques of conservatism that you might not have heard. And then you can go back and think about, like, well, why is that? And what's the answer to that? And then you become a much more effective conservative. So you can only grow stronger in your convictions by engaging with people who disagree with you. And also just because it's good for the health of the country.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
Hey, Mr. Thiessen, is that how you pronounce it?
Thiessen.
Okay.
My name is. You drink, sin like you confess.
Okay, great. Thank you. My name is Will. I go to Bishop Ireton High School. I'm a senior there. My question was, as someone who has worked in the political world for a little while, especially with governmental agencies, mm-hmm. what is the best thing we can do to ensure governmental agencies specifically are protecting free speech in an era when the FBI is investigating Catholics for attending the traditional mass that Buckley and Russell Kirk both loved? Yeah. So my question is, what's the best thing we can do to ensure our leadership is protecting free speech when there are just so many abuses of power in these organizations today?
Yeah. So the number one thing to recognize is that the people who are abusing power are not actually the majority in those organizations. That in the FBI, there are lots of, I mean, there's been tons of FBI whistleblowers who've come forward to call this stuff out. And so there are good, most FBI agents are good people. We don't want to, somebody recently suggested we should defund the FBI. I think that would be a big mistake. We need to reform the FBI. We need to give it better leadership. And the key is to be politically active and elect people who are going to reform those organizations and who are going to defend free speech and defend your liberties. And to be politically active and to express your voice and don't let them silence you and call them out. Because that's the way they succeed is by silencing us. So that would be the number one thing I'd say.
Thank you.
Hi, I really enjoyed your speech. My name is Alejandro. I go to Fresno State. My question is, what advice do you have and what authors do you recommend for those of us that have a love for writing and want to get into the world of politics and become a political speechwriter? What advice do you have for us?
What you should read to become a speechwriter? I mean, read everything. I mean, read voraciously. Read literature, read novels, read, especially speech writing, which is writing speeches is very different from writing columns or writing for the eye and writing for the ear are very different, right? It's like the difference between playing a piano and a pipe organ. Similar keys, but different skill, right? And writing for the ear, and especially if you want to be a speech writer, there's some poetry involved, right? So read poetry. Know history. Read the great speeches. William Sapphire, who was President Nixon's speechwriter, and he became a columnist at the New York Times, conservative columnist at the New York Times, he wrote a book called Lend Me Your Ears, and it was a collection of all the great speeches of history going back from Cicero to Ronald Reagan and beyond. So read great speeches, and just read voraciously, and you'll become a good writer.
Thank you.
All right, we have one more question.
Hi, I'm Joe. I go to Purdue. You talked about how you transitioned from being a liberal to a more conservative mindset. So I'm wondering, my go-to for converting someone who is convertible would be economics issues.
Sure.
So I'm wondering what your... How you started coming around on things? Was it economics, social issues?
I was very passionate about. So when I was a liberal Democrat, I was what they called a Scoop Jackson Democrat back then. My family was. My mother is from Poland. I traveled behind the Iron Curtain. I was very anti-communist, and so I was what existed back then, which doesn't exist today, which was an anti-communist Democrat, and so foreign policy was a big issue for me at the time. But, you know, I think that one of the ways to persuade people is to use analogies and word pictures that make people think about things through a different prism of their own lives. So, for example, you know, we had a big debate over missile defense and whether we should have ballistic missile defense to defend our country from, say, North Korean missiles or Chinese missiles or Russian missiles. And, you know, some people said, well, you know, the they know that we have defenses, so they have other ways to attack us. And so the answer to that is, well, you know, if you lock your front door, does that mean you leave your windows open for someone to break in? You have to defend against multiple ways to get in. So you want to use analogies. I mean, with equity, the analogy I used earlier in the speech is like, you know, when I was explaining to my kids what equity, the problem with equity, I said to them, you know, so you get an A, you work hard. And so one of the other students gets a C. Should you both get a B? And they say, no, I earned that A, and they didn't work hard, and they didn't earn it. Well, there you go. I mean, you've just made the case in equity. So find things that are relevant to their lives and to their experiences, and that's the best way to convince people.
Thank you.
All right, one more round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you very much.